Hello everyone, I'm Michael Purvis, and this is the Daily Michael for Tuesday, January 31st, 2012. Well, it's very nice to be with you all. I continue to struggle with the tech end of the whole Daily Michael process, but I am working on it and learning as I go. I do have a friend who is probably going to come sometime in the next month or so and hopefully really do some heavy-duty work on the tech, but I am continuing to do everything I can to make the picture as clear and to have as few jumpings around of myself on the screen as possible. There obviously is some sort of difficulty with the processing in these videos. The audio and video continues not to link up quite as well as I would like, but hopefully we'll just look at it in the big picture and things will improve as we go along. I do have several new things for you in regards to the Daily Michael. My partner continues to have his me time or him time, and I am continuing to record in the evening, and that seems to be working for us. So here I will say good evening to you, but it may be the daytime when you are watching. I also have made a little sheet where I can write down all of the songs and include a few of those in the description in the show more drop down box below the video, but also put the songs at least in partial form in the tags. I don't have room to list every single word, so they're a bit abbreviated, but I think if you look below in the tags, you can make out what the songs are for each episode of the Daily Michael. So that's a helpful and new thing. I also, as well, have brought in my mandolin and dusted it off and tuned it, and I brought in my baritone ukulele, and I have three recorders now. I normally have those things in my studio with where my students can see them and see the various things they can study, but I decided to bring them into the recording room so that I will be more likely to use them and show them to you all. So I hope as I begin to implement those in the program, you will enjoy seeing and hearing them. I will go now to the What's on Michael's Mind section, and let me just say that some people, I think, since the Daily Michael appeals to a variety of ages and sorts of persons, some people may enjoy the What's on Michael's Mind section. Some may think I really am not too interested in what's on this silly older music playing dude's mind. I just want to get to the music. So you can, if you want to, just kind of move your cursor along in the little line below the video and go about a third of the way in, a quarter to a third of the way in, and get right to the music. But if you're the sort of person that enjoys introspective things and having something to think about each day when you watch, then you may want to listen. So here is, I will share with you an email that I sent to a friend. I mentioned that my partner and I were having some difficulties. We've been together for about 12 years, and every once in a while a little something rears its head, and we have to wrestle with it, and then it's on to the next growth opportunity. You know how relationships are. And this latest one just sort of involved timing and schedule, which seems, to go right along with 2012. You know, it's said that time has been speeding up and everybody has been dealing with all sorts of things that need sort of tweaking and updating or throwing things out of their lives that are outmoded and so forth. And supposedly we are all to be ascending into a 5D Earth, which I find a fascinating concept. So there's changes in the air for us individually and as a species, if all of this 2012 stuff is true. So I'm not surprised, really, that things have not been flowing for me and that I've been having to really work and prioritize and so forth and sort of get myself into a new mode. And I'm not surprised that this is so for my partner and I. But it was one of those little struggling, wrangling with things, and I did write an email to my friend about it because I just didn't really have anyone else to talk to. When I was a young man, I saw therapists and all that sort of thing, but been there, done that. That's a different part of my life, so I generally wrestle with things myself and with God, and occasionally I reach out to a friend whose advice I trust. So this is what I wrote. Hope all, besides email, is well. My partner and I are doing much better. I told him I sent you a long email, as I am always 100% honest with him about all things. Just wanted him to know I was upset and reached out to you, having no one else, really, I felt I could talk with about the subject. Interestingly and synchronistically, I am reading, as a part of my Daily Michael video program, one of my stories now about a little girl named Penny, who was longing for a friend to talk to about her troubles. It is called The Chipmunks Knew, and that friend she longs for turns out to be a little chipmunk. You all know that if you've been following along. It's a children's story. It is interesting that my partner feels he needs friends or a special friend to chat with. I have reached out to you, my friend, to speak my troubles to. I suppose God is showing me that, despite my hermit tendencies, I need, and we all need, connection to each other. We all are, after all, connected and one, even if we have the illusion of separation. So it's interesting, you know, I find that there are these little synchronicities, you know, and if you begin to just be aware of them and pay attention to what's going on in your life, I think you will see them too. I think that relationships are one of the prime ways that we grow, and I think also there's, you know, our relationship to God and the universe, and I think one of the ways we sort of see what's up with our growth and with our relationship to God is through these little synchronicities, these meaning-fraught coincidences. So in this case, you know, my partner is feeling the need to have a bit more friendship and connection in his life and be chatting in the evenings during what used to be our time, and I was a little bit jealous about this and a little confused. And then I just kind of see that, well, this is what needed to happen. I needed to record, and he needed to have some time to himself and time to chat with others and sort of reach out into the world and relax. And then there are all these little synchronicities. You know, I find I happen to be reading a story about a little girl who it needs a special friend. And I found that I was discussing something similar with a student as well. So, you know, it just begins to pop into our lives, this theme. And this happens all the time. This is one of the ways that if we're paying attention, we can sort of get a better handle on what things we are supposed to learn, how we're supposed to grow. It's sort of like God, I think, however we conceive of God, just sort of knocking on the door and saying, hey, you, pay attention to this, pay attention to that, pay attention to this. You might see something on a billboard. Your little nephew might say, blah, 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 blah. You might see a television commercial, blah, 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 blah. And you might open a book, and there's something on that subject, blah, 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 blah. And soon you begin to get the idea, oh, God, now I understand. You want me to pay attention to this, or this is important. So that's how, in my view, that's the way that synchronicity works. So that's a little section, just some thoughts for the What's on Michael's Mind section of our program. Let us go now to our opening theme song, and I'm going to grab my 6-string guitar and, of course, bonk it on the music stand there. Let me get out my little music just in case I forget the words to the theme song. Probably I won't, but I'm just a little shy of 50, and being a 50-year-old, sometimes things that we think are there are suddenly not. So I've got my music just in case. Well, I see when I look in the monitor here that I'm wearing my red shirt. I wasn't too sure how that was going to look with the red curtain in the background. It looks about like I thought it was going to. Doesn't quite match, does it? Hopefully it's not hurting your eyes too much. All right, let's do our theme song. We're singing the old songs like it's Saturday night, because that's what we're about to do. We're about to hear a poem and a bit of a story and sing a bunch of wonderful old songs, just as folks used to do in the evenings. My dear elders, who I performed for about 20 years doing Lions, always used to tell me that when they were young, people used to kind of make their own fun, and they would sing a lot and dance, and sometimes people even played instruments, made their own fun. So let's do that. That's what we're about to do, too. Do you remember the old songs that we used to sing? And no matter
scatter our troubles, what joy they would bring. Oh, my dear ones, a-singing was such a great sight as we gather round the piano on a Saturday night. Do you remember how the music would fill up the room? We'd make up the harmony and sing to the moon. So take your shoes off, put your feet up, and sing with all your might. 'Cause we're singing the old songs like it's Saturday night. We're singing the old songs like it's Saturday night.
All right. Well, that's our theme song. We will move along now to our poem for the day. We've been reading out of my Harp and Quill series. It's a 5-volume poetry series. Each volume in its entirety is available to you on my YouTube Michael Author All Ages page. And if you look in the featured playlist in the, I think it's Poetry, Music, and Art by Michael playlist, you will find all of the Harp and Quill volumes. Now, if you would like extra copies of any of my books, you can go to my 3 websites, music-outreach.com, which has materials for the elderly, and abundantchange.com, which has uplifting books and recordings and videos for people of all ages, children through elders. And you can go as well to PlaySingUnDream.com if you would like home study courses or live lessons. Any of the instruments that you see in the Daily Michael program, I teach in my studio here in Indianapolis. So if you happen to be in the Indianapolis or surrounding areas and you'd like to learn to sing or play an instrument, or maybe you're a composer or a lyricist and you need help with that, you can contact me on the contact page there on Play, Sing, and Dream. And the rest of you, there are home study courses available on that site. All right, so those are my websites. If you need extra copies of anything, you can find pretty much everything I've created on Michael Author All Ages page, but extra copies, go to the sites. And those extra copies would be good for things like birthdays, anniversaries, or just anytime you want to cheer somebody up. All right? Okay, let's go to our poem. This is a poem which is a portrait. In this series, the Harp and Quill series, the poems are divided into categories, and this category is a portrait poem. And interestingly, the portrait is of the feline sort. It's about a little kitty cat. I had a wonderful cat. He was a Devon Rex cat, sort of one of those hairless cats. I was allergic to cats horribly when I was a little boy, but I found that the hairless cat, which really isn't hairless, but has kind of a down, and it doesn't have that dander that you find on ordinary domesticated kitties. So I was able to have this cat and was thrilled to find that out. And my little Willie was with me for several years and unfortunately had a heart attack. I really missed him. He was a delightful kitty. He kind of looked like the Egyptian cat statue that you've seen. Is it Bastet, I think, maybe? But the cat kind of looks like this, and he has very tall, pointy ears. And Willie was a lot like that. So this is a poem that I wrote about my kitty cat. It's called The Last Time I Saw Kitty, or On the Hard Life of Little Kitties. The last time I saw Kitty, there wasn't much to see. He darted through the room, past the Christmas tree. He sees what I do not, hears sounds I miss as well. And what it is he's chasing is very hard to tell. The life of little kitties is hard, as you must know, for there's many a thing, many a string, many a mouse about the house to be hunted, chased, and batted about, requiring little comment, except perhaps one dainty, small meow, stating kitties on the prowl. Kitties rather reticent, a cat of little words, unless one fails to fill the bowl. He thinks that's for the birds. And finally, of course, and most importantly, kitties must nap and nap and nap and nap some more, you see, on my bed. What? What's this? Making noise? Meowing up at me? Kitties most sorrowfully upset, as I can plainly see. Excuse me, kitty, my mistake. Now, how could I forget? Kitties nap on kitty's bed. I guess that I'm the pet. Well, you know, that's so true, isn't it? Our animals, they just sort of let us live in their house. They tend to kind of take over, don't they? And we gladly let them do so because we love them so much. They, well, sometimes they're better than humans, aren't they? We humans can be jealous, you know, or hard to get along with, or give our love conditionally, and our pets tend to love us very unconditionally, especially dogs. Kitties are a little more aloof, I think, but it depends on the cat. My kitty cat, Willie, he was much more like a dog. He would come when called and was extremely affectionate, and I was very, very lucky to have him. So that's a little poem about my kitty cat. And we will leave behind our poetry section. We will go to the folk song section of our program. And I'm going to grab my... Well, let's see. Maybe I should try something different. I usually play my classical guitar at this point. Maybe I'll try the baritone ukulele. Now, I'm not going to promise anything because it's been a little while since I've played the ukulele. And as I've explained, I used to have all these songs in my head. You know, hundreds of songs, and I could just play them all from memory. And I'm trying to do that again, but since a lot of them I don't have the music for, or, well, I probably have the music, but I would have to go looking for each one. So I'm just trying to get back into the flow of remembering all those songs. So you'll have to kind of be my guinea pig for a few episodes here, and I might forget a line or two. So I'm going to play an instrument I haven't played in a while, this baritone ukulele, and do some songs I haven't played in a while. This is the baritone uke. It's bigger than the soprano, and there are several sizes of ukuleles, but it's kind of nice because it's designed to be tuned like the first four strings of the guitar. I do tune my mandolin, as I've shared with you, and my soprano uke like the guitar too. I've kind of adjusted the strings and the tension on the neck in some cases, but this one is designed to be played to be tuned like the guitar, which is really nice. So essentially you just pretend like you're missing the last two strings of the guitar, and otherwise guitarists can play it. So let's see here, a folk song. And I'm going to tune just a little bit. I tuned this a few minutes ago, but it's kind of like a car you haven't driven in a little while. You have to get it out on the road and get some of the dust blown out of it. And instruments are very finicky. Just a little gust of wind or change in temperature or humidity or strumming a bit on them and they can be out of tune. All right, so this is our baritone uke. Well, I should pick one that I'm sure that I can do. Well, I think I can do this. I told you I've been including these Irish songs as folk songs, and even if they're not officially folk songs, they have that feel. This is a little song called Too-ra-loo-ra-loo-ral. That's an Irish lullaby. And this very soft baritone uke would be good for a lullaby. Too-ra-loo-ra-loo-ral.
an Irish lullaby.
Shall we do it again? I'll bet many of you know this one. Let's sing it again. Hush, now don't you cry. All together. That's an Irish lullaby. All right, that's a pretty one, isn't it? Played on our baritone ukulele. Okay, well, it's time to go to the part of our program where we hear our story. We're hearing the little story about Penny, the fourth grader, whose life seems to be perfect, and we describe it in sort of Bradbury-esque fashion, all the wonderful things about her life, but then her parents begin to not get along. So she's dealing with something that many children must deal with. And in my stories, I often try to pick topics that will help, will guide, will uplift. And so a lot of folks deal with divorce. A lot of adults remember divorce in their childhood, and a lot of children are dealing with this. And she feels, as I mentioned in the beginning section of the Daily Michael, of our episode today, that she really kind of needs a friend, a special friend. She could talk with her friend Charlotte that she plays dolls with, but, you know, Charlotte doesn't really quite understand. And she knows she can talk to God, as her Sunday school teacher indicates, but, you know, that still small voice, it's not quite the same voice that you can hear just like you could on, say, the radio or a television or a tape recorder. So she's longing for a special friend she could really speak to, and lo and behold, strange as it seems, it ends up being a little chipmunk. So, we will pick up where we left off. Penny thought, well, I don't know what to make of this talking chipmunk. But soon my daddy will be home. This fact made her feel happy and a bit more secure, for her father's return each day from work was one of the cornerstones of her world. She sat thinking of his return, knowing that she could depend upon it. She watched the flowers blow in the breeze and shine in the sun, and inspired by the confidence of her father's return, she thought, without distress, of the amazing, just a little disconcerting appearance of her furry, new, little friend. Was he imaginary? Had she really seen what she had seen and heard what she had heard? Thought young Penny. She was not entirely, not 100% sure of the answers to these questions. Nevertheless, she did feel, somehow, that something magical and rather wonderful was happening to her. Imaginary or not, she was glad she had made a new friend. And so the year progressed. Penny remained friends with her chipmunk buddy. They continued to converse, though Penny told no one. She indeed had a special little friend to whom she could tell all her troubles. Halloween came, Christmas too, and life progressed pretty much as Penny expected it to. It occurred in much the same way that she had grown, to which she had grown used. Sometimes her parents still argued. Sometimes there were unhappy faces in Penny's household. When this happened, she continued to go to the library and read of faraway places, or lay on her bed and cover her ears. Penny worried, but tried to keep a brave face. What did she worry about? She worried that her parents might get a divorce. She had heard her friends talk about such things at school, and indeed some of her friends' families had experienced this thing called a divorce. And what exactly was this thing, this divorce? Penny came to understand that this meant that her friends' mothers and fathers did not live together anymore under the same roof, and that the children in these families often would spend time with one parent and other times with another. The thought of this made Penny very unhappy. She could not imagine sometimes being unable to talk with her mother, or not smelling baking bread and cookies or macaroni and cheese. She wanted to always know that her mother was in the kitchen preparing these wonderful treats, just a few steps away, as she sat on the porch step waiting for her father to return each evening. Now, I realize I've presented kind of a traditional view of mom and dad here. It could be dad staying home and cooking meals for the family and mom going out to work, or more than likely in today's day and age, both parents going out to work. But sometimes things are still traditional. Nor did she want to imagine a day when her father would not come home pulling up in his big red car. She hoped to always be there on the front stoop waiting to see him, striding down the sidewalk with his briefcase, crying, "Princess!" She could not imagine a day, being a good day, that did not end with her running and jumping into her father's arms. It was the proper and joyful end of every school day for Penny, and each work day for her father. Yes, she worried and wondered what life would be like if there was such a thing as a divorce in her family. She was afraid that one day her parents might call to her, ask her to sit with them in the kitchen, at the table, and in a serious tone, tell her that the dreaded divorce was going to happen. And yet, all through the school year, this did not happen. It did not happen. And that is where we will stop, and we will continue on with our story about Penny and see what does happen to young Penny. Well, that is our story from my abundant storybook, by the way, available in its entirety on abundantchange.com. We'll hear some more next time. If you want to hear the individual stories from that very huge anthology, as I mentioned, you can find them right here on my Michael Author All Ages page. And the there's a playlist that says something like Michael's Lit Children through Senior Citizens. And you'll find all of those stories in there. But if you would like the whole volume, go to abundantchange.com and you'll have this great big book that you can share with all members of your family, anyone from children up through senior citizens. Okay, let us go now to our American song. And, well, we didn't use the classical guitar like we normally do for the folk song. So let's do the classical guitar for our American song. Just a little fine-tuning there. Oh, let's see here. We did the caissons go rolling along. That's an Army song. Now this is the Marines hymn, if I can remember all the words. From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we will fight our country's battles from the land and on the sea. First to fight for right and freedom and to keep our honor clean. We are proud to claim the title of United States Marines. And that is our Marines hymn, one of our American songs. Luckily, I remembered the words. All of a sudden, I was afraid that the little spoof on that, something about keeping our desks a mess and all of that, that I remember when I was about a fourth grader, I was afraid that was going to pop into my head. But luckily, the real words to the Marines hymn were there. So, whew. Okay, well, let us go now to the Guess the Name of the Song section of our program. And I'm going to plop a book up here on the piano. And let's see what we've got that we can do for a Guess the Name of the song for today. Oh, my poor book is not going to stay open very well. I've got it all taped together. Let's see if I can find something that will stay open. Okay, this is a cute one. Now let me see. I think I could play this on the mandolin for you, and we haven't seen that yet. So this is the mandolin. Now, as I've explained to you, I handle my what I call guitar satellite instruments a little bit differently. And all you purists out there, don't eat my liver. I know that it's a little unconventional, but I tune my mandolin like a guitar, and I've got actually all of my guitars and instruments tuned down half a step to be easier upon my voice. So this is tuned like the guitar, the first four strings of the guitar, but down a half step. So it sounds a little different, sounds a little weird, but I can very easily then just have one set of chords, one fretboard in my mind. It doesn't get confusing, and it's very easy for a guitarist then to play all sorts of instruments. You can tune a banjo that way. Yes, it is not what a purist would do, but you can do it. And of course, there's the banjitar, which I use every episode on the Daily Michael, and it essentially, you know, it's six strings like the guitar, but looks like a banjo. So at any rate, here we have this mandolin tuned a little differently. I tuned it up. I haven't played it in a while. Let me just see. Yeah, it needs a little fine tuning. I haven't used it too much lately, so it's a little bit like that car that needs to have the dust blown out. Okay, now we'll see if I can play this song for you from 1907. I'll play the tune, and if you know the title, shout it out. Oh, that just... I gotta fix that. There, that's better. All right, let's start again. I'll turn the page here. I didn't do too well with that. Let's just try that again. I see some notes that I need to leave out. I thought it was going to have all the notes on the mandolin, and it didn't. Just a little more tuning. All right, let's try it one more time. I won't tell you the title yet because I want to do it one more time. I just need to get back into playing this mandolin. Hope you don't mind being my guinea pig. Remember it? It's called My Gal Sal. We'll see what it sounds like playing the chords on the mandolin. I'm getting used to this teeny tiny, I don't know if you can see that, but the fretboard is just teeny, teeny, teeny tiny. And I've gotten, now that I'm almost 50, kind of tubby. And it is a very, very small fretboard for a big guy to play upon. Although, you know, your fingers aren't supposed to gain that much weight. But at any rate, it's this tiny little instrument, and I'm a little bigger guy. So let's try this again and see how I do. They call her frivolous sound. A peculiar sort of a gal, with a heart that was mellow, an all-round good fellow, was my old pal. Your troubles and sorrows and cares, she was always Okay, and that is My Gal Sal, our name, guess the name of the song for this episode of the Daily Michael, played on the mandolin with a little bit of a different tuning. Purist, please don't eat my liver. All right. Well, we will leave behind that section, and it is time to go to our Let's Sing section. I'm just going to plop a book up here. This is the book from my 12 thematic programs. I have 12 different, well, there are two four-volume sing-alongs on my music-outreach.com site, and one has verbiage in between the songs, kind of like what I do here on the Daily Michael, and the other is just the songs. It's called Just the Songs, Volume 1 through 4. And it has no verbiage in between. Then there is this thematic sing-along with a thematic part at the beginning and then a sing-along at the end. And there's one for each month. So I'm just going to open up the book here and see what the universe would like for us to hear. Okay, these are all public domain songs. And we've got our nice piano here. So we can use that. Let me fix my pedal here. All right, oh, I just need to reach down here and fix it. There we go. Okay, this is called M-O-T-H-E-R, Mother, a word that means the world to me. So this is for all the moms out there. I read a poem that I wrote about my father yesterday, and I shared with you that I've been really lucky. I lost my mom when I was 10 years old. My mother, who was a very spirited sort of person and very scholarly, she was going to get her doctorate, and she was a reading specialist, and I think she probably would have gone very far with that had she been able to do that. But I had a wonderful birth mother who did all kinds of things with me, taught me to read when I was 3 years old, and did all sorts of art and creative projects with me. I know that to a great extent I am the way I am because of my birth mother. And then there is my stepmother, who I shared with you is, she's done many things in her life, but now she is a minister and actually a district superintendent with the Methodist denomination. And she's a lovely, lovely person. So I've had two wonderful mothers. So this is for all the moms out there and the grandmothers, too. If my Grammy's watching, I love you, Grammy. All right, are you ready? M is for the million things she gave me. All means only that she's growing old. G is for the tears were shed to save me. H is for the heart of purest gold. E is for her eyes with love light shining. R means right and right she'll always be. Beautiful topic. Actually, I think I'm in my Mother's Day program there. Okay, let's see what else we've got that might be nice. Oh, here's a good one. Another public domain song. I need a little drink. I don't have to reach behind the curtain for my tea. Covering up the label there. I don't think we're allowed to show any labels of products in our recording. All right, this is I'm thinking an old Al Jolson tune, and it's called You Made Me Love You. All right, one of my favorites.
You made me love you. I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it. You made me want you. And all the time you knew it. I guess you always knew it. I didn't wanna tell ya. I do, you know I do. Give me what I cry for. You know you got the bread of kisses that I die for. You know you made me love you.
And you know what? I had better just write these songs down, because my addled, almost 50-year-old brain is probably not going to remember these, and I'm just flipping through the book. So we did You Made Me Love You, and we did M-O-T-H-E-R, a word that means the world to me. And that way, when I go and put these in the tags, I will remember. Otherwise, I'll be flipping through the book all night trying to remember what I did with you all. Okay, we're just letting the universe see what we might do tonight for our Let's Get Everybody Singing part of the program. Okay. This is a nice one. This is a pretty one. I was going to say Stephen Foster. It says, music by Sir Henry Bishop. Lyrics by John Howard Payne. Oh, yeah. Home Sweet Home. Let's try this. It's true, isn't it? There is no place like home. Remember what Dorothy said when she clicked her heels together?
May it rejoice and passes, though we may roam, be it ever so humble, there's no place like home.
Been on vacation, you know, and you had a wonderful time, and you are driving home, and you get in your home state, and it's just the best feeling, isn't it? Because you know that you're almost home. Well, let's see here. I'm looking for something nice for us to do for our last Get Everybody Singing song. I'm coming across a lot of inspirational tunes, but we're saving those for the end. Well, okay, we did By the Light of the Silvery Moon yesterday. How about Down by the Old Mill Stream? Oh, and I better jot this down. All right, so Home, Sweet Home, and Down by the Old Mill Stream. Okay, are you ready, everybody? I guess I'm going to have to put my pen in a better place. Kind of around the corner there. Okay, let's try it.
Down by the old mill stream, where I first met you, with your eyes ablow, dressed in gingham blue, it was there I knew that you
those are our four Let's Get Everybody Singing songs for this episode of the Daily Michael. M-O-T-H-E-R, Mother, a word that means the world to me. You Made Me Love You, Home Sweet Home, and Down by the Old Millstream. Okay, everyone, we are going to go to our prayer. Actually, I could just leave this up, couldn't I? And then we'll come across a nice hymn to sing at the end. Okay, let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our very lives. How wonderful it is just to be able to breathe, to be able to eat and drink water and all sorts of wonderful tasting things that we experience every day. We take these things for granted, but how wonderful it is. And how fortunate we are if we're in the United States of America. Most of us, even if we're not doing as well as we used to or having trouble with the economy, we're pretty well cared for. Will you please help those who really are having trouble? There actually is a lot more poverty in our country than there used to be, and there are people living in cars, dear Lord, and all sorts of problems, even in the United States. So will you help us to remember when we're feeling crabby that there are folks who are really suffering, and will you help those who need help? Please just make sure that everybody in the world has enough water and food and heating and cooling, a roof over their heads, family and friends, education, all the things that we need. There truly is enough in the world if we put our hearts and minds together and just ask for your help, God. We know that we can make a difference. Sometimes it seems like we don't have much time left. There are so many problems in our world, or pollution and overpopulation and sustainability and so forth. So we ask you to help us to not be selfish and to work together, make sure everybody has enough, because there is enough for everyone, and just to make this world the beautiful paradise that you intended. Please be with anyone who's lonely tonight or feeling upset or worried or scared. Just help each of us to know that we need only to turn to you and give all our troubles to you, and that with your help we can make changes in our lives, and all the things that we need will come to us. Thank you for just every good gift. Thank you for our lives. We ask this in your name. Amen. Okay, let's do a neat song. Actually, this kind of goes along with the prayer. Didn't plan it that way, but you know, we talked about if we all put our hearts and minds and together and ask for God's help and try not to be selfish and work together, we can make the world a paradise, you know, a beautiful garden that God intended. And one of my favorite of the old inspirational tunes is the song In the Garden. So let's do that. And as I always say, you know, the theology in the songs might not be exactly yours. The words I used in my prayer might not be exactly yours, but that's not important. The important thing is that we're people of goodwill, and we're coming together, and it's the love and the intention that is underneath our prayers and our singing and our inspirational songs. That's the important thing. We all come from different places, different cultures, different religions, but we're all human beings. And that's what we have to remember now and always. So let's sing In the Garden and think of what a beautiful world it could be. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. Everybody sing, I know you know this one. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, another has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. truth. God, no matter what, God is always with us. You know, He is walking and talking with us. Doesn't matter whether we say God is a he or God is a she or what the specifics of various scriptures and books are, God is love. And God is with each and every one of us. And God is in that face of that person that you look at and in all the things around us. All one, all God, all love. That's what I believe anyway. Okay, well everybody, I hope that you are having a wonderful day or a wonderful evening. It's been just great to be with you all. Please don't hesitate to send me a little comment or a note. Please be nice. I know sometimes people on YouTube like to, just for the sport of it, sort of eat somebody's liver, but send me a nice note. Just let me know that you liked a certain song or just enjoyed sharing the music together. That uplifts me so much and encourages me just to know that you're there. I see, you know, numbers that certain number of people have watched a video, and it's great just to know that I'm able to share music and uplifting thoughts and words with others. But I lead this kind of a sort of a hermit life, which is perfect for me. It's what I need. I used to lead a very active sort of life out in the world, and I've sort of pulled in, and I do my writing and artwork and composing and stuff during the day, and then teach a little bit and record in the evenings. And it's kind of a quiet life. I have my partner, and I had a little doggy that I love very much up until just recently. But it's the sort of life where when I hear from folks and just connect with them, it means a lot. So I'd love to hear from you if you would care to send a little message or a comment. All right, let's finish up with our goodbye song medley. And I'm going to grab my banjo guitar. And as I shared with you, if you can play the guitar, you can play the banjo guitar. That's one of the great things about it. Let's do our goodbye song medley. We'll start with Till We Meet Again. Smile a while. Kiss me sad at you. When the clouds roll by up under you, then the skies will seem more blue. Down in Lover's Lane, my dearie, wedding bells will ring so merrily. Together. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to leave you now. Merrily, here we go. Merrily, we roll along. Roll along, roll along. Merrily, we roll along. O'er that deep everybody, until we meet again on the next episode of The Daily Michael, hopefully tomorrow, keep smiling and have a wonderful, wonderful day. Bye-bye now.
I suspect there's another reality shining through all the noise and the banality. Oh, to pause, to look and see what a gift is that pause to you and me. Noticing the real beneath the commonplace. Going through my day, sometimes there's no way to see. No time to stop and peer close enough at you and me. We're millions of atoms, but mostly we're just space. If I could really see you, I'd see more than your face. I suspect there's another reality shining through all the noise and the banality. Oh, to pause, to look and see. Oh, what a gift is that pause to you and me. Noticing the real beneath the commonplace. Noticing what's there beneath the lines of your face. What's underneath our skin is much more akin to grace. What's underneath is real, where love fills every